Hi, my name is Dr. Richard Ford, and I'm the Chief Scientist over here at Forcepoint. I want to talk today about something that I think is really interesting, and that's how AI is going to change how we deal with people, especially in the security world. The title of this talk is Minority Report, because I think most of you will be very familiar with the book and the film of the same name. So what was the plot of Minority Report all about? Well, what it was the concept that we could basically use the ability to predict into the future to stop crime before it happens. Now, in the movie, what we see are predictions that are pretty sort of futuristic. This thing is going to happen. But the basic premise is that we can do something very cool, and that's stop crime before it happens. Now, what's interesting about that in the movie, of course, is again, it was very sci-fi, but what I want to tell you is that this idea is actually not in science fiction anymore. It's within the realms of reality. So what we have the ability to do today using artificial intelligence is make pretty good predictions about humans. You're very familiar with that from the advertising world, for example. You can predict who's going to click on a link or who might be most likely to buy a product. The question is, can we do that to say who's most likely to become an insider threat within an organization, or who's most likely to get infected with a new piece of malware? And then once you know that, what can you do about it? Because I think it's one thing to be able to predict. It's another thing to know how do you deal with that prediction? Because even if I can predict with 99% surety that you're going to do something bad, that still means I'm wrong one time in 100, and nobody wants to be a number. So when we talk about analytics, I would say that there's a progression. So if you think about simple analytics, I would call them analytics that let you detect something that's already present in your data. So I might use analytics. You probably use analytics today in your SIM to look at the data and say, hey, I can see that this negative security event happened. Even though, you know, I didn't observe it directly, I can see all the pieces of it. I can see the sort of shrapnel. That's powerful, and that's a useful technique that we use every single day. What's more interesting, though, is to get ahead of that curve. Can you predict something that's going to happen? So you have descriptive analytics, that's telling us about the past or the present, and you have predictive analytics, and that's saying, what do we think is likely to happen? So predictive analytics give us this glimpse into the future. What can you do with that glimpse? And that's really what we're going to spend our time talking about today. So the first thing I want to say is that predictive analytics isn't a crystal ball, right? This doesn't mean this will happen. It means it's very likely to happen. And likely is not the same as well. So for example, there's some very solid research that says that we can predict how likely a particular person is to leave a group or to leave a company. And in and of itself, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. Every single one of us at some point is likely to leave the job that we're in. It's a perfectly normal part of being an employee with a company. We'll join, we'll do our job, we'll leave. But when people leave, there are very specific risks that go around that. So it's useful to be able to predict who's a flight risk and then kind of address those risks. So if it's key personnel, for example, you want to do things that retain them. Maybe you take a proactive stance to say, hey, you know, I know that you're not happy. How can we improve your working conditions to make your job fun again or more fulfilling? Or what's the underlying problem? So these things can be very positive. They can also be very negative. If you predict that an employee is going to leave and suddenly decide that you're going to restrict their access to maybe the most sensitive information the company has, all kinds of things that are negative can happen, because you might take an employee who was just loosely a flight risk and turn them into very much really a flight risk. So predictive analytics, when we use them for computers, which we do, by the way, every day, I can predict the probability a website is going to be harmful to your computer, and I can do that with reasonable accuracy. That's one thing when I block a couple of packets because I think they might be bad. So it's a very different thing when we block a person from doing their job. And that's what I'm talking about when we say that humans in the loop here and humans being the target of AI. We need to take this human-first approach because, let's face it, predictive analytics can be kind of creepy. What do I mean by that? Well, again, I think there's been a lot of talk in the media over the last year or so about, you know, doing prediction around people, maybe by looking at data that they can gather from social networks, which way you're going to vote, how you're likely to relate to a particular ad or a particular messaging to maybe change that opinion. And so we've seen many good examples that an insider threat program can, when done wrong, be a little bit creepy. It can be a bit big brothery, that people are looking over your shoulder, and nobody likes predictions being made about them because, again, you're unique, but most predictions are done sort of more generally, so people like you have done things like this. The classic example is, you know, marketing, where a marketer loves to predict couples who might be expecting a child together because they are a marketer's dream because brand loyalty goes right out of the window and it's an opportunity to sort of sell, sell, sell. And this done right can be very effective. It's good for the customer and it's good for the brand, and there's no real intent to do anything with that data. But when you randomly start receiving ads for new baby clothes, for example, it can be a little bit, I think creepy is the right word, about how you feel. I mean, how does this vendor know that I'm pregnant when I've only just figured it out? And of course, they know based on historic buying patterns. They know in general based on age and demographics. So done incorrectly, this can be a negative to your employees. And what I want to do is encourage you to do this in a very humane, human-first way. So what do we do about that? There's a call to action here. I'm going to take you through three of the high-level points, which, of course, in the full talk, we'd go into a lot more detail around. So I want you to avoid legal pitfalls around this. Be human-first, not technology-first, and I can't stress that enough. And then consider the opportunity and challenges of taking predictions and turning them into action, because there's a lot of opportunity there, but as the first two will show, there are also some pitfalls. So first of all, there are a bunch of potential legal issues that can come up when you look at insider threat programs, and that's particularly true when you start making predictions about your employees. You need to make certain that when you make predictions, you're not pulling in protected characteristics. For example, age or race or disability. These are things that we shouldn't be making decisions based upon. But it's easy to accidentally do that as a second order effect of your data. So you have to be very careful when you use these models about how you apply them to people and how you do it in a way that always protects your people rather than hurts your people. So that's very important. There's a whole set of legal issues that you need to think about very carefully when you start applying AI predictive analytics to your employees. The second thing is I think it's really important that you view this from the employee perspective. Nobody likes to think of themselves being a number, yet when done correctly, we're all actually pretty comfortable with things like the FICO credit score, which is essentially a predictive value that talks about the probability that I'll become delinquent on a loan, right? So again, done properly, these things can work well, but it's important that you don't say, what can we do? It's most important you ask yourself for your employees' benefit, what should we do? So I want you to replace that question of, well, what can we do or what's legal with, what's the right thing to do with respect to this prediction, and then how can we most effectively apply it to our people? And then finally, predicting something is only useful if you can do something about it. And what I want to encourage you to do is look for ways that you can use those predictions in a constructive way rather than punitively. So for example, we might decide that one of my coworkers, Rachel, is a high flight risk, and maybe she's going to take some data with her. That would be a reasonable prediction for an AI to come up with. However, instead of blocking her access to that data, which would be a harm to her, especially if our prediction is wrong, maybe we could just encrypt that data if she tried to copy it to a USB drive. That would be an example of a mitigation that doesn't put her in a bad situation, but also, you know, allows the company to protect its critical assets. When you move to risk-adaptive protection, you become proactive in how you protect your data, which at the end of the day is what security is all about. But when you do it right with this human-first perspective, you can do it in such a way that you don't penalize the users that you'll be making predictions around. So that's sort of the Cliff Notes version of what we'll be talking about. I'd like to invite you to come join my session. In fact, there's a whole stream of things going on that morning that I'll be talking about AI and how we can use it, how we should use it, and how we should not use it. And I hope to meet you face-to-face at the conference and we can talk about it. So again, this is Richard Ford signing off, and hopefully I'll get to meet you in person. Thank you very much.